So that committee that is all for debate and scrutiny and discussion around how we progress things. But I give you an assurance that we will look at it as we can.
So
that's
the chair. I'd like to thank Mr. Anderson for his budget today. My question is in regards with affordable housing. The mayor mentioned building more housing on the higher band scale. My question is, you know, we didn't really hear much about affordable housing. I want to hear more about affordable housing, particularly in the south of Liverpool, as there is a severe shortage. Also, regards the mayor also mentioned that, you know, there's more green space in the city. Well, we seem to be losing quite a bit of green space. The city centre has already got St. Nick's, it had Big Steph Gardens, which now sadly is really lost. You know, we are in severe shortage of green space in the city for the residents who we are hoping to move in. Also, the office workers, you know, we're going to get more office workers, and their health and well-being depends on green space. They have to have green space to go and have lunch. Or for children who live in the city centre with their parents, you know, I do think that you need to start talking more about, you know, the creation of green space in the city centre. You did not mention this at all today.
Two things. You raised the issue of affordable housing, but many years the council has supported the RSLs in the development affordable social housing in our city. And there's been other housing built as well, 11,000 of those. But that's somewhere near good enough. I predict you probably could do with somewhere around about 2,000 to 4,000 to 5,000 social housing, affordable housing for people to rent and to buy. And that's why Foundations is going to challenge that and tackle that. Also, whilst we demand that our RSLs also do more in the city. So we are doing that. I think with the greatest respect, we've done more social housing under our tenure in office than the Liberal Democrats ever done. So, and I suggest you don't share the figures, but we will do more, and we have to do more. And we want to do more because it's needed, and so we'll carry on with that. With regards to the so-called Big Steph Gardens, which I reminded you before was Exchange Street Station, and the back end of the lines, the railway lines of Exchange Street Station. But the fact of the matter is that you wouldn't get jobs coming into the city for people to want to go and eat the lunches at lunchtime if we weren't developing grade A office space for the future of this city moving forward. And I'll remind you that I don't really care what you say or opponents of mine within my own group say, or indeed our erstwhile colleague over there in the Green Party. In this city, under my leadership, we've created more green space than we've ever had in our city in its history, and with more to come. So, as far as I'm concerned, our city will continue to get the support of this administration to protect and support green space. But at the same time, we'll also recognise the challenges that we face as an administration. And we won't shirk from our responsibilities of doing that, despite the leaflets and the rubbish that get put out on leaflets by the likes of your party.
Are those statements noted and endorsed?
Lord Mayor, can I advise members that card votes will be conducted as prescribed within Standing Order 25.2 of the City Council Constitution when amendments of the budget motion are considered? It will be recorded in the minutes of the proceedings whether members cast their vote for the decision or against the decision or whether a member abstained.
Can I move the budget recommendation for 2019-20 as attached to Appendix A, the notes of Appendix A, set out on page 16.
There's been an amendment received from Councillor Crone. Is there a seconder?
It says in the motion that we're going to refund all the effects of the noise coming out of the council. Could you read that up, please?
Yeah, explain that again, please.
It says that you're going to read about section 151 of yourself.
Okay, section 151. Officer can advise the council that this amendment is lawful. This is attached to the notes and appendix B as circulated. Councillor Crowe.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Before I go on to move my main amendment, please could I just move a minor amendment as a response to something that was mentioned in the Mayor's presentation. It's on page 88 of the main agenda of this meeting. Second, it is item number C13, Oxford Corner Country Park. Following what the Mayor said, can this line now be deleted?
Councillor
Crowe, what would you say? I just thought it would be beneficial for the record if that was clarified. Okay, and just before I go to my amendment, I also just want to clarify one thing that was discussed in the presentation. The Mayor was presenting the southern grasslands of the Festival Garden site as a new green space, but that's always been open to the public. And so there's no chance there's any... Yes, it
has. For information, the whole site was owned by Lantry. Yeah, the whole site was owned by Lantry. There was a percentage of that land open because we had groundwork trust to give us some money, and we put in some money, and that was what we did, not what Lantry did, what anybody else did. So as far as what we're talking about is a sliver. We've now invested more money and opened more of that space, and it's our intention to protect 43 acres of it.
Councillor
Brown?
Anybody who knows the area will know that you can could have access to some of our at any point. But anyway, moving on.
Can we move on, please?
I've lived in St. Michael's Ward for 19 years.
I've lived in Liverpool for 61 years.
That would be difficult for me to achieve. Anyway, can we get on? To my main question now. Lord Mayor, I would like to place on record my thanks to the hard work of council officers who've been involved with the process of setting this budget. There is no doubt that the continued impacts of austerity make each year more of a challenge. And I'm extremely grateful for the teamwork and resilience of council officers in all departments for keeping services running despite these huge challenges. In recent years, our budget amendments have consistently called for more money to be allocated to children's services and adult social care. While the pressure on these services is still intense, the recent announcement that Liverpool will recruit 160 children's social care staff, and the fact that adult social care is currently within budget, mean that we have decided it's possible to turn our attention this year to the defining emergency of a generation. That is the climate emergency that is rightly being declared in other councils across the country. The UN has said that we have 12 years left to cut our carbon emissions in half. Another report, also from the UN, shows that the difference between 1.5 degrees of warming and 2 degrees of warming is the difference between millions more people being impacted by global warming. It's the survival or the extinction of all the world's coral reefs, and it's the disappearance in summer of the northern ice caps. We've already warmed the planet by 1 degree, so the importance of action could not be starker. And it's not too late. The solutions are out there. All that is needed is for politicians to put the money where their mouths are and start the green revolution. And that is exactly what our budget amendment does. We propose the creation of a £120 million climate emergency fund. This will give a budget of £30 million per year for the next 4 years to be spent on carbon reduction measures. This includes tried and tested measures such as renewable energy installations, home insulation, and sustainable transport, as well as pioneering new ideas, which Liverpool can become a leader in, such as carbon extraction and moving away from private car ownership by the promotion of a council-run, city-wide community car club. None of these actions alone is revolutionary, but taken together they represent the beginning of a green revolution. This investment will benefit the people of Liverpool, not just because our air will be cleaner, our roads less congested, and the climate deaths are a threat, but in more direct ways too. With better insulated homes, we can start to tackle the scourge of fuel poverty. As shared ownership of vehicles becomes the norm, people who can't afford a car today will, in the future, have access to one. With the investment in the vital green measures, we will create jobs and new opportunities for Liverpool-based businesses. I'm in no doubt that given the pressure on council finances, to really achieve long-term ecological sustainability will need government investment as well. But we cannot afford to wait for Whitehall to decide as a climate emergency. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change has already made it abundantly clear there is one. So it's the responsibility of every decision maker at every level in every country to do whatever they can to secure the future for our children and all generations after that. We can decide tonight to respond, to make changes to our business as usual plans and start a journey towards a greener future. Or we can duck the decision and kick the can further down the road. Only there's not enough road there, we are close to the cliff edge. It's decision time. Tonight we either choose to invest £120 million in Liverpool transformation, or we decide instead that most of that money into road repairs. I spend time in Liverpool Road like everyone in this room, so I know they are in those deep investment. That's why our budget only takes a proportion of the highways investment fund. Each year we still allocate an additional £10 to £50 million for road repairs, so that is a significant increase. We feel this is adequate to address the most urgent repairs and make the roads as safe as possible for all road users. Therefore, we have a choice tonight between committing an enormous sum of laying down more time so that we can carry on to fall or we can face up to the challenges before us and choose a new path. And let's be no doubt, approving our amendment tonight will put Liverpool on the map. This will be a major statement from one of the country's major cities that enough is enough. It will show the way for other local authorities and it might even finally change the government into action. If we can take decisive actions despite everything they have thrown at us, then what on earth are they waiting for? With half the world's population living in cities and over half the world's carbon emissions coming from cities, we have to be leaders on this issue. With our coastline, our wind, and much more solar than Manchester, Liverpool is in prime position to lead the way on renewable energy. Liverpool is a city which knows how to pull together in a crisis. A city that has reinvented itself before and which can do it again. If we as city leaders show vision and leadership, there is no limit to what we can achieve. This is a balanced and legal budget proposal, and it does not require additional council tax to be raised. It's a simple reallocation of funds to reflect an urgent priority. I therefore recommend this climate emergency budget and urge council to accept it.
Right,
I've got six speakers before
we
respond,
so please speak to council again.
Well, we will be voting against this amendment today. I'm not allowed to talk because the certificate has been given by our director of resources, which is lawful, but to echo what's happening in the House of Commons at the moment, the question is it meaningful? And I don't think it's meaningful at all. I don't think there's anyone here that would disagree about the problems caused by climate change. I'm an asthmatic, And I know if I go to some parts of the city sometimes, my mum's going, we sell coffee, and there's many people here that will be affected by that, and some far, far more seriously than I am. But how do we deal with it? And what are the problems that we ourselves can actually deal with? Because many of the problems are problems that are not of our making. We have lorries coming through the city, thank goodness we do, because they service the ports. A quick way to get rid of the problem would be to abolish lorries and close the port now. Well, that's not a sensible idea, but it's probably as sensible as some of the ideas in this amendment, all of which might be worthy, but of which for this council remain totally unproven. So let's say we have got the amount of money that the Greens think we should spend on this. Is it really best to spend it in the way that are indicated here? Why don't we pick two of them, put all the money into just two things? Because what we don't have are any outputs or performance measures which tell us what would happen if this money was spent. Well, you have no idea which of these options are best. Seems to me that someone has said, oh, we've got X amount of money, let's put 2 million here and 4 million there, and this does seem like a letter to Santa Claus rather than a reasonable way of dealing with a vital issue. And I'd like to suggest there are two ways we could deal with it. The first one I don't recommend what we could do would be to have a special council meeting on this subject. But if we did, and this motion came forward, I'd still vote against it. Or to take the hint which the mayor gave us as to a way forward for dealing with things in council better, to devote, like, is it the next proper meeting apart from the annual meeting in June? Instead of having lots of small motions, why don't we spend 2 hours discussing climate change? Against a paper which all our spokespersons and our officers have contributed to, which has a series of fundable and viable options, so that we can decide not from a shopping list, but from a hard list of things that we can all agree on because we know what will work and how they will work. So I wouldn't want anyone to think that we don't share the concerns of the Green Party, but in some ways we're even more concerned that they've moved an unproven, uncosted motion with no ideas of timescales, with no ideas of mechanisms, and no performance measures at all. And that is no way to spend £30 million a year of taxpayers' money.
Councillor
Bradford. My Lord Mayor, can I make a general comment? I'm disappointed by Councillor's response, because we all know council budgets aren't going to be exact size, because they develop during the year, we have violence from one part to the other. It's actually setting out a place where the priorities are. And whilst I may actually understand where every single detail of the annual motion, I think the thrust is quite clear. And I think many people who've been watching TV only 2 days ago, Warrington, a unitary authority, launched a massive investment scheme into creating their own energy that actually will reduce the running costs of the city as well as improving the environment. Now, if a motion is to be dated, I think in many ways they're about a direction of travel. And I think the direction of travel the Greens on this occasion, I've ridiculed many times, is actually right. I think it would be worthwhile us putting some money aside to give a commitment to look at energy saving and environmental sensitive measures that could actually generate income. I use the very colloquial example, which I used before. We have a massive amount, I think it's 5 million of unspent Section 106 monies. I can't comprehend why other centres we aren't putting solar panels on every public building, community building, reduce the running cost of the buildings, and save the community money using capital in your own budget to improve investor save. There is a real need to investor save. There's a real need to invest and save to save the environment, and we can do both. So on the direction of travel, I can vote for the motion, and that's going to be turned down. But can I make a broader appeal? communities and people of Outturn and the trade unions made a thoroughly positive contribution. I wouldn't detract from that. I would have thought this sort of issue, rather come to a budget debate with its finality of yes and no, is the sort of thing that could be looked at a budget working party. But I'm going to say to colleagues from the Greens and the Liberal Democrats, if the Mayor gives the City Council an opportunity to do that again, then you've got to be responsible and not play the hokey-pokey of being in one minute and out the next. I was embarrassed when we had councillors sitting around the table having a debate. I've got to give thanks to Ross. Myself and you often disagree on one thing, and Paul and Joe and I debate, and Joe and arbitrate, and we flush out some really good issues and some genuine concerns, and we have across party boards. And we had a lot of input from the first class officers of the board. And it meant, I think, the decision making was better. I make no apologies, we played a small part, but we were able to do it. I was embarrassed when some of the oppositions came to the table, agreed to keep things confidential, and the next minute we saw a press release ridiculing suggestions. In fact, one suggestion that came out of the story really was the one about his own. Bless you. Some people seem to believe you're in his life. It really was a bit rich to complain about the suggestion you actually put on the table. I think if you don't down the amendments, I'll vote for it because I think it's the right direction to travel. But it is turned down. I hope the Mayor will, in I think a very gracious way, give the opposition a chance to look at this sort of detail when we have next budget so we can actually get things by cross-party agreements. Because it did work and it can work. And I think the direction of travel is right. Even if I don't agree with every single clause, it's about making a commitment and a change.
Councillor Jones.